Hello there, my fellow fans of Christopher Lambert and Adrian Paul, and welcome to another episode of the Battlemechs of Battletech. Just like the title says, today we will be covering a very famous and very powerful battlemech known as the Highlander. It doesn't need much of a prologue, so without further ado, let us proceed, shall we? Some stats on this big guy include: it does belong in the Assault class at 90 tons, its top speed is 54 kph, and its rounded price is 8,936,000 C-bills. The Highlander is one of the most well-known Starlink Defense Force Assault mechs, serving with distinction for almost two centuries since entering service in 2592. Initially designed as a dedicated city and installation defender, the original model featured a variety of weaponry, along with 15.5 tons of ferrofibrous armor. But maybe the most useful asset of the Highlander were its free Hildco jump jets, giving it a jumping distance of 90 meters. The heaviest mech designed to actually have jump jets at the time, their original task was to allow the Highlander the ability to jump over obstacles and outpace other mechs with a faster ground speed. However, because of this increased mobility and its versatile weaponry, the Highlander proved to be a very capable fighter on any kind of battlefield. And within just a few decades, nearly every regiment of the regular and royal armies featured at least a few of them. However, it was during the design's initial trial runs that pilots began using these mechs in what would infamously become known as the Highlander Burial. Leaping into the air and landing directly on the head of the enemy, a Highlander could literally drive a lighter mech into the ground. So successful was this maneuver that the design team re-engineered the legs to withstand repeated death from above attacks and turned what had been a desperate maneuver into an art form. As with other Starlink era designs, the Highlander would suffer the loss of technology brought about by the Succession Wars. When Starkor's factory on San Hoa was devastated at the end of the Second Succession War, the original HGN-732 became virtually extinct. An agreement between Starkor and Hollis Incorporated to rebuild destroyed chassis from scratch did keep the line going until the mid-3030s. Eventually, limited production was restarted by Starkor on San Hoa and Kauri, producing about a dozen of them a year. These HGN-733 Highlanders were used in small numbers by the Capellan Confederation and the Lyran Commonwealth, commonly as part of lances which also contained exterminators, victors, grasshoppers, and catapults. Unknown to many, Comstar also maintained a large stock of Highlanders left over from the days of the Star League, which they gifted to the Draconis Combine during the War of 3039. The appearance of so many rare Highlanders had a large impact on Lyran morale during that war. Comstar would also use the design in their own military, the Comguard, and even during the Clan invasion, a few original 732s would take part on the field as part of the Clan's fighting forces. Also, the unit known as the Northwind Highlanders especially favored these battle mechs. In fact, during the Succession Wars, they were the only Inner Sphere army to keep a large number of them operational, alongside Comstar. The Highlanders were especially skilled in delivering the maneuver known as the Highlander Burial. By 3057, Starkor's San Hoa line was at full production once again, producing brand new original-spec Highlanders for Lyran units of the Federated Commonwealth. Luckily, just in time to take part in the Fedcom Civil War. Highlanders would continue to be made all the way through to the Jihad, where advanced variants would fight both for and against the Word of Blake. The Highlander carries a weapon load that is more at home when fighting the enemy at range, but when the range is close, the Highlander can still get a job done. The main weapon is an M7 Gauss rifle that is capable of stripping armor off the enemy one ton at a time. This is backed up at long range by a Holly 20 LRM-20 launcher. For close range work, it carries two Harmon Star-class medium lasers and a Holly SRM-6 launcher. 2 tons of ammo for the Gauss rifle, the LRM, and the SRM launchers provide good endurance, while the use of case grants added protection. Relatively low heat buildup from the weapons allows for a nearly continuous barrage without taxing the 12 heatsinks over much, though the pilots must still maintain some level of caution. A few variants of this thing include. Also keep in mind that the pictures don't always accurately portray the variants. The HGN-694. Introduced during the FEDCOM Civil War, this Highlander replaces the missiles, the medium lasers, and the jamjets with 2 large lasers and a heavy Gauss rifle. The M7 Gauss rifle remains in place. The HGN-732B. This one is an upgrade of the classic 732 model built exclusively for the SLDF Royal Units. It drops 2 heatsinks and a ton of SRM ammo, and an Artemis IV FCS is added to the LRM and SRM launcher, while the heatsinks are upgraded to the double-strength model. Additional short-range firepower comes in the form of a medium laser added to the right torso. The HGN-733. This one is actually a downgrade of the Highlander, although it weathered the use of more primitive technology better than the other SLDF designs. In place of the Gauss rifle, the mech now carries a Midron Class B autocannon 10, while the rest of the Highlander's weapons have remained the same. The armor has also been upgraded by 2 tons, providing even more protection than the original 732 model. The speed profile of the Highlander maintains the original model speed of 54 kph. The communication system is a Hartford COM A7. The HGN-734. This Highlander emphasizes on an urban combat role, produced by the Lyran Alliance in the wake of the Civil War. The Gauss rifle was replaced by a massive LBX autocannon 20. The medium lasers were upgraded to ER medium lasers. The SRM was upgraded to a Streak version with another Streak SRM 6 launcher added, as well as another ER large laser. Upgrading the standard fusion engine to a new light engine and removing the LRM 20 allowed all these changes. The HGN-736. This is the Comstar version introduced in the late 3050s. And upgraded to carry the improved C3 computer, as well as upgrading the LRM 20 with an Artemis IV fire control system, and replacing the SRM 6 to a Streak SRM 4. This was accomplished by replacing the 12 heatsinks with 10 double heatsinks, and using only 1 ton of ammo for the upgraded SRM launcher. The HGN-738. This is yet another upgrade by the Lyran Alliance following the Civil War. Its largest weapon is a heavy Gauss rifle. The long-range missile launcher is replaced by an LRM 15, although this one is guided by an Artemis IV fire control system, with an ER large laser providing even more long-range firepower. Should the enemy get closer, it can bring to bear a pair of ER medium lasers and a Streak SRM 4. The HGN-641X2. This Comstar-developed variant is equipped with a pair of Artemis IV enhanced MML-7 launchers with 4 tons of ammo. It keeps the Gauss rifle of the standard Highlander and mounts a pair of ER medium lasers. Case 2 systems protect the Gauss rifle and the missile ammunition from explosion. A C3 slave unit allows this Highlander to share targeting data. Light ferrofibrous armor and a reinforced structure provide protection. Last but not least, and also since I'm such a great guy, we're also gonna talk a bit about the Highlander 2C. One of the most popular Starlink-era battle mechs, many Highlanders accompanied General Alexander Kerensky into exile. Some of them were mothballed, but many found their way into the Tumans of the clans. As technology advanced, the weapon systems were upgraded until the design known as the Highlander 2C finally came out. With the use of newer, lighter weapons, the damage potential of this Highlander was almost doubled. The 2C also contains enough ammo that it rarely requires any resupply. The clan scientists, however, were forced to rearrange the placement of some of the weapons within the mech to allow it proper ammo feeds, but the design is largely unchanged. It carries the maximum amount of ferrofibrous armor that can be crammed on the frame, about 14.5 tons. Just like the original, the 2C carries jump jets to move up to 90 meters at a time, allowing mech warriors to execute the famous Highlander burial. At long range, the pilots of the 2C have an EMRG Captain Series Gauss rifle and a Type 26 Great Bow LRM-20 launcher at their disposal. Once the enemies get closer, they can bring to bear a pair of Streak SRM-6 launchers and a trio of medium pulse lasers. 12 double heatsinks can deal with any heat problems. Another couple of brilliantly named variants of this thing include the Highlander 2C2. This variant was introduced during the Jihad in 3072. It is fitted out as an all-range combatant with a small focus on anti-infantry. It retains its Gauss rifle and Streak SRM-6, while designs exchange the LRMs for free ATM-6 launchers with 4 tons of ammo. ATM in this case stands for Advanced Tactical Missile. The medium-pulse lasers have been exchanged for a trio of ER medium lasers, and for an anti-infantry role, it has 6 anti-personnel Gauss rifles mounted in the left arm, with 1 ton of ammo for them. Endosteel has been added to the design, allowing for a small increase in armor protection. The Highlander 2C3. This version, instead of the Gauss rifle, carries a Hyper Assault Gauss Rifle or HAG-20 with 4 tons of ammo, and also an ECM suite. And this, my friends, has been what I wanted to tell you about the Highlander Assault Battle Mech for today. It is definitely a very versatile and powerful mech, with the added benefit of being very mobile, at least for an assault. Is the Highlander among your favorite battle mechs? What do you like or dislike most about it? As always, do feel free to share any thoughts, opinions, or experiences you may have had with it in the comments below. Was the episode informative or entertaining? In that case, please click the like button and subscribe for future content. You can also click the bell notification icon to stay more up to date. Thank you very much for watching, and I wish you all an awesome day. This is GDN signing off.